So professionalism versus amateurism. Obviously, there are rugby players earning a lot of money these days. Is there a resentment from some of the old guard that they didn't get in on the act?
Oh, I think so. I think there's got to be. You know, I'm pretty lucky that I do other things. But I think there is a lot of people of my era. For example, if you took, let's take Mike Teague, for example. Great player, magnificent. He'd be a world icon now. But Mike Teague is a great man. He's got his own building company, but no disrespect, he's still up a scaffolding or doing things on a wet Friday afternoon, you know, where some of these players, he can go to Gloucester and see people on £150,000, £200,000 a year who quite basically and quite honestly wouldn't be able to lace his boots up. So I understand people getting bitter and twisted. I'm not saying Mike is, but people of his ilk when he goes along to see what's being paid. And of course, the rugby is the marketplace can't sustain it. You know, I'm very much pro-player, but unless we can sort out the wage structure, how much they play, the game's going nowhere and we will continue to be beat by the Australians of the world until we sort it out.
You mentioned your early part of your career. You had a fairly checkered disciplinary record. I think it was Jack Rowell that got you back on the straight and narrow, really, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. Jack Rowell, I always remember Jack Rowell, the big man himself, got such a big name in rugby, and of course in business, he's a, you'd call a captain of industry, I think is the sort of term you'd call it, chairman of various things, from Spillers to Dalgetty. But I always remember he joined the club exactly the same day, same year as me. He rode into the training field in his big, brand spanking silver Mercedes, I think it was, and I walked in with me Bristol City bobble hat on. Caught the train and bus across. You know, it was that sort of era. But I think he always had a healthy respect for me. He was a great tactician. He was a captain of industry, I think they call it, you know, chairman of various big companies. And there was I, a rough nut from Bristol that was unemployed and just wanted to get in about people. And I think he had a respect because he was a realist. He realised that although we had these great players in John Horton and Mike Bees and John Palmer and David Trick, these great players, you needed somebody actually to do some nitty-gritty up front. And remember in them days, every side had a bit of a hatchet man. You know, nowadays they all moan about contact. The game's, no doubt about it, is quicker and bigger and faster. But in them days, it was quite violent, you know, whether you like it or not. And each club had somebody that needed to be sorted out or they would sort out your best player. So I think Jack was realistic enough to realise that maybe this young lad from Chilcott, you know, from Bristol, might be worth the place. And I learned on the hoof. I always remember my first game. And, you know, they talk about crowds now, but this was on a September 1976 at Pontypool Park, Pontypool, Wednesday night, 14,000 people in the stadium. You know, well, you know, they talk about 14,000 now. There's not many happens apart from internationals. And I played against a great Pontypool, Welsh front row, you know, Faulkner, Windsor, Price. I was 19 years of age. I thought I was full of it. I was the best thing since sliced bread. And I soon learned that there's always some yard around the corner. And in particular, it was Graham Price on that day. And he still has my utmost respect. He absolutely killed me. I think that was my first experience of going bald because my head was down round where it shouldn't be. It was unbelievable experience. He absolutely creamed me. And next year, he creamed me as well. But every year, I got better until he retired. Then I had the bugger.
Your relationship with the Welsh has been interesting, to say the least, hasn't it? Let's take that at the International in 87.
Yes,
you got into all sorts of trouble, didn't you?
Yeah, well, we...
Well, not the only one, though, were you?
No,
that's a blame where it's
yes,
due.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely. But yes, the Welsh had always been a big game for us. Bath had learnt the hard edges by playing every Welsh clubs twice. So when we went to Leicester and Moseley and Harlequins in them days, it was tough rugby, but skillful rugby, but not really hard. So I was brought to, I played Wales a few times, but of course we, in 87, we went to Cardiff in the England team, and we hadn't won there for a lot of years. I think it was something like, off my memory serves me right, something like 24 years. And the great Welsh side of the 70s were still ranking, and it was awkward. And we had a good side, and we sort of won. We went there, and in fairness, we were a good side. We had to win there. We had a chance at the championship. It was a wet, damp day at Cardiff. They had a couple of good players. They had Robert Norster in the second row. They had Robert Jones still sort of kicking and playing his best. And they had Mike Hall outside. But really, they were a side there for the taking. And everybody had tipped us. And of course, it was the first year, really, when what I would call tabloid papers had got involved with rugby. It's now sort of come out with the help of Will Carlin and people of these ilk, we'd now become a sport that people wanted to see so and read about. So the Sun, the Mirror, the tabloids were there, you know, really going. And to be honest with you, without it, it became pressure that none of the players had ever experienced before. And it was not a game of rugby, it was the Battle of Cardiff. It was, you know, the English against the Welsh. It was the old, you know, the old cliches. It was horrible. And of course, living near to Wales, i.e. Bristol, 28 miles away, 3 weeks leading up to the game, wherever you went, there was somebody saying, you've got to beat the Welsh, or there was some Welshman saying, you ain't going to beat us. And of course, it was a bit awkward because my father's Welsh and I married a Welsh girl. So I'd done my bit for Anglo Welsh and they hadn't spoken to me for about a week leading up to the game. So we weren't in good moods. And we left our hotel in Chepstow. I got to be honest, we were so psyched up we'd have et anything in red, let alone played rugby against it. We sang the national anthem, and there was, you could have heard a pin drop. And then, of course, when the Welsh sat in the old Cardiff Farms Park, and that the feeling was unbelievable. But I always remember the first line out, which was a real trouble one, and everything went up. It went up like Beirut. It was unbelievable. Nervous tensions, the Welsh were under pressure as well. It just went up. Woof! Up it went. Everybody was hitting everybody else. And Wade Dooley had felled a guy called Phil Davis, their second row, and fractured his cheekbone, and he went down. And Bob Norster, the great Welsh second row, said to Dooley, "We can take that all day." And big Wade Dooley said, "You're going to have to." And that sort of set the scene. That set the scene. And sadly, England went looking for men rather than ball, which meant in the end we made our compulsory mistake. Rory Underwood and John Webb had a mix-up. They scored the try. Robert Jones was outstanding. Rob Norster won every line-out ball against Wade Dooley, who was just trying to knock his head off. And in the end of the day, we undermined ourselves. So, what happened? The Welsh were heroes, and we were banned. There was myself banned, a guy called Graham Dawe banned, a hooker. Wade Dooley himself was banned. And what I thought was very unjust was our little scrum half captain of the day, Richard Hill, who was a bit fiery but didn't do anything, was banned for not controlling us. Well, how, you know, he's 5 foot eight and a half, you know, 10 stone dripping wet. How can he control me, Dooley, from going for it? So I felt that was a bit unjust. But anyway, everybody got back apart from me and Graham Dawe, who had to sort of sit out a bit. I was on the bench. I was banned for a couple of weeks or a couple of games. And then I didn't get back in the England side for about 18 months, which probably equates to 12, 13, 14 caps in them days.
I think you're quoted as saying of that day that you could have played the first 10 minutes without the ball and nobody would have noticed.
Oh, absolutely. It wasn't in anybody's game plan. You know, the ball was not in anybody's game plan. It was just England, Wales, old hatreds coming out. And to be honest with you, it wasn't a game that I'm particularly proud of. You know, we can have bits and pieces and have nits and gritty, but you can have it fun along the way. This was bordering on, you know, over-the-top nastiness, which sadly is beginning to come in sport a little bit. But, hey, you learn your lesson. We have a great saying in the West Country, you can't babby ass. You know, you make your bread, you lay in it. So I laid in my bed, but thankfully I got back.
How did you take that suspension? Because for all the aggression that is in rugby, there's still far more integrity in rugby than most other contact sports, and people do take it quite badly if they're put on the sidelines.
Oh, it is indeed, because I think there's a certain honesty about, now people say a certain honesty in sort of an aggressive game of rugby, but it is a game where it is still, even now, you can actually hit bells and bells out of each other, and the first thing you do is look up your opposite number in the bar, you buy him a beer, no matter what nationality, no matter whether he can speak English or not, and you have a beer with him and you shake hands, and it's sort of an unwritten thing that, right, well, if you know, you got a better me next time, I would. But I think I learned from experience. My debut was a problem to me, you see. We played in 84 against a magnificent Australia side, and we seem to be talking a lot about Australians beating the Brits at the moment after the Lions tour. But they came over in 84 with a magnificent side, and they grand slammed us, which means they beat Ireland, Wales, Scotland and England, obviously. And it was my debut at Twickenham. And I always remember it to the day. They had a side for those anoraks out there. They had a side comprising of a young Campese, a name we'll all remember. Ella, Gold, Slackford, Jones, Rodriguez, Poydeman, Cutler, Law. Oh, if there'd been a World Cup in that era, they'd have won it, undoubtedly, as they did in 91 and as they did recently. They were unbeaten, I think, for something like 15 months, back-to-back wins against the All Blacks. They were putting us to the sword on my debut. Frustration ruled. Halfway through the second half, I knocked Nick Farr-Jones, the Australian scum, half to the ground. There were 60,000 people, Englishmen, in the Twickenham saw it. 8 million on BBC saw it, but the referee did not. So it was a great result for me. I even got away with it next day in the newspapers. The papers wrote things like, It was an act of frustration that made Chilcott hit Farr Jones. Or it was a symbolic England approach that made Chilcott hit Farr Jones. It wasn't. He was a sledging little bugger. He was one of these Aussies that from the minute you kicked off, he knew he was good. And he told everybody how good he was. Referee, that's not straight. Look what he's doing there. Looking. And I always remember, he upset me. He upset me when he ran past me on my debut. Imagine it. 60,000 Englishmen in Twickenham, me red rose on me chest for the first time ever, a schoolboy dream. He ran past me on my west stand at Twickenham. Me mum and dad was in the stand. He ran past me and all he said was, come on, fatty, catch up. Oh, Jesus. Well, I tell you, it took me 10 minutes, but I caught up. But England never picked me for another three games after that. I got a lovely letter framed in my study saying, dear Gareth, blah, 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 congratulations on your first cap, but we felt that you were a little bit over-vigorous, they said, and we would be looking at your selection within two or three games. So that was another truth. So it was something that I was... It was the mentality of the RFU, and I'm not anti-establishment because I think they run a great game, but I always remember another game, England versus New South Wales in Australia. And it was just before the test. And the coach had come to me, a guy called Martin Green, and said, look, we need somebody to lock this scrum out. If you lock this scrum out today, in this game, you're in against Australia at Ballymore in Brisbane Saturday. So we played. I was playing against a guy called Peter Kay. He was a local Aussie Hard man. He was an ex-biker, ex-doorman on, you know, the Sydney Hard clubs. And he was there going to do some pommy bashing. This was how the Australian press had built it up. We went out and we had... it wasn't a great game for England, but we locked the scrum out. I did exactly what I was used to. And just as the game was... just the final whistle went, I could see him coming up to shake hands, as all good props, no matter what a battle you had. And we did have a bit of a ding-dong. He came to shake my hand. And as I held my hand out, I had a funny feeling. You could sense that maybe this wasn't going to go quite right. And in front of the main stand at a thing called the Concord Oval, he just swung a big haymaker at me. Caught me on the top of the head, which is unheard of in rugby. You know, he'd only been playing for 2 or 3 years. He was a big hard man brought into the side. And a big haymaker, and he sort of just glanced my head. But certainly if it had caught me, I'd have been, you know, stretchered off. But I sort of wrestled him to the ground just to control him a bit. Everybody broke it up. But we went into the changing rooms. And literally, within 5 minutes, I was in the shower room with the management talking about they were going to send me home, they were going to discipline me, when it was clear on video evidence that he tried to strike me after the game. And then within 5 minutes in the Australian New South Wales changing room, they'd already confirmed that Peter Kay was going to win his first cap Saturday against England to do some pommy bashing. So that was a difference in mentality in them days. I was nearly sent home. He was fast-tracked into the side because he showed aggression against England. And it's hopefully it's changed a little bit now in the professional era. But in them days, you did have to fight that. You make your bed, so you lie in it. But certainly, there was a certain attitude that changed from country to country.